Thank you all for coming. There was some doubt whether there'd be more audience members and speakers or the other way around. So I'm glad it turned out this way. This is sort of the subtitle of the talk. This is the context of the talk. We'll be talking about bad guys trying to stop communication, but you know, they're not all powerful. Yeah. But to compare with, we'll look at all powerful bad guys as well. Roughly speaking, this is in between two worlds, the world that you know I often inhabit, the world of Shannon, where noise is random, it's not malignant, it's not benign, noise is never good, but it's not malignant. And the other world, where there's an actual adversary, a bad guy who's out to screw you. Yeah, and many of the models I'll be looking at will be somewhere in the middle. There was a workshop organized around this theme in Banff. Many of the videos and talks are online. You can go take a look. I encourage you to do so. This talk, again, credit where it's due. I should, of course, mention many people, including especially the students. So much of the work I'll be talking about, giving most of the talk will be just background. But if I do get to some of the original stuff, I should acknowledge people who will be hopefully around in the community for a while. So Swanand Kadhe is a student of Alex Sprintson's. Some work was done with him. Zitan Chen has just started a PhD. Much of the work that actually I'm quite proud of was done when he was an undergrad. There was a stock paper that came out of it. He's now started his PhD at UMD. I hope for good things from him. Eric Zhang has just started his PhD with me. Mayank Bakshi, Anand Sarwate, and Bikash, they're in the information theory community, and I'm sure you know those guys. And Mike Langberg is somewhere here. And the team, I already made the joke on Wednesday, so I'm not going to belabor the point here, but anyway, can do it. Alice wants to talk to Bob. She sends a message, she has a message, she wants to send it to Bob, and she encodes it so that Bob can hopefully decode even if there's some noise. And we'll often think of the noise as some bad guy, Calvin. Now, the system diagram is something like this. There's Alice encodes the message to a code word of, shorter message to a longer code word, goes through a possibly noisy channel, possibly adversarially noisy channel, there's a received vector, and then hopefully you want to decode this, right? Now, on one extreme, when the world I sit in, often information theory, the noise is random. It's encoded to some xn, it's transmitted over some alphabet of size q, this will be a parameter we'll talk about. The redundancy, the rate is k over n, it's sort of the inverse of this is the redundancy. Some noisy version comes out, and then from this you want to reconstruct what was transmitted, hopefully with high probability. And the parameter of interest is often the number of errors, right? So the three parameters I'll be talking about the most will be the rate, the alphabet size, and the fraction of errors, roughly speaking. In the Shannon world, this is well understood. So 1 minus the binary entropy function for if you have bit flip errors for binary alphabets. For large alphabets, in some sense it's even folklore, but for large alphabets you can get 1 minus p because it's basically the Qiaosheng Zhang entropy function for any q, really. So when q goes to infinity, the Qiaosheng Zhang entropy function basically just behaves like p, so therefore you get 1 minus p. And anywhere in between, there is exactly a 1 minus hqp. In fact, you can even achieve there are computationally efficient codes, essentially linear time codes that achieve this capacity as well. So really, this problem is very well understood. There are still, of course, open problems here, but there are second, third, fourth order questions. Okay. On the other extreme, the Hamming world, much less is known. So it's a similar setting, right? But now the Calvin gets to see exactly what is transmitted. He knows everything. And based on what he sees, he gets to flip some p times n bits just to make things comparable. And in this case, for example, in the large alphabet case, we have the singleton bound, which tells us that no more than 1 minus 2p is achievable. So in particular, no positive rate is possible when more than half the symbols are flipped. And they can be achieved, in fact, computationally efficiently with Reed-Solomon codes. For the binary alphabet, things are much harder. There is essentially no tight characterization for p less than a quarter. So it's no positive rate is possible when p is greater than a quarter. For p less than a quarter, the best outer bound is a LP bound by McLeese et al. And the Gilbert Washmore codes are the best achievable. And in fact, if you demand computationally efficient codes for the binary alphabet, then you can't even achieve the Gilbert Washmore bound. It's a very different story than the random version, right? So at these two extremes, on one hand, we know much. On the other hand, we know very little. So the question is, what if you weaken the adversary a little bit? And some other extremes, some other sort of benchmarks. OK, actually, before going on, so a slightly technical issue, but maybe worth spending a little bit of time on. So often when we think of the Shannon world, our metric is a probability of error going to zero. And a probability of error going to zero averaged over noise, over messages, over randomness in the code word transmitted for the message. And I'll talk about this a little bit more. So we have an average probability of error metric. But even if we demand a maximal probability of error metric, that is, for every message, the probability of decoding incorrectly goes to zero, this is also possible. And in fact, you don't pay a penalty for it. The capacity turns out to be the same in both of them. Let me also just highlight this thing here. It'll turn out to be important in some models. I'm explicitly allowing you to average over the code words transmitted per message. Because a priori, even if the messages are uniformly distributed, there's no reason for you to have just a single code word per message for you to have a deterministic encoding. You could have multiple code words, possibly with different probabilities for the same message. And indeed, for certain models, this turns out to matter. You do want to have some weird distribution on the code words as opposed to the messages. So it turns out, basically it doesn't matter. All of these things, you get back to the binary entropy functions, for example, if you're looking at the bit flip model, okay? So it's a robust model, doesn't matter what your error metric is. It's this 1 minus HP is a capacity, okay. In contrast, let's look at the Shannon world, the Hamming world. And here, we often think of a maximum probability of error metric, roughly speaking, because there our usual demand is, it's basically like a packing problem. Instead of a squishy packing problem, like here you're allowed to have some small overlaps, here you demand that for every message and every corresponding code word, there be basically no overlap between these balls. If there's an overlap, then the adversary can push in that direction, right? And it's a natural question to ask, well, what if you allowed some randomness? What if you allowed for an average probability of error? So you demanded that the adversary be able to do whatever he wants, but maybe not too many balls overlap. And it's not too hard to show. I mean, maybe those of you who already know this. But it's not too hard to show that this relaxation also doesn't help. Basically, this is also a relatively robust characterization. We don't know what the capacity is, but the capacity is equal in each of these cases. Okay, so yes. Basically, it's a little bit subtler because you could, in principle, have different probabilities for different balls, and then you have to argue that even if that number is slightly small, blah blah blah. But it's essentially that idea. You can formalize that idea. Okay. And I just wanted to make this point to make sure that we understand what the metrics are and to understand that they're robust. Okay? By the way, converse arguments, especially when you relax it to this, in some models get hairy because often in coding theory we're used to converse arguments which go like minimum distance properties, but if you're relying on a small probability of error, for some models it's non-trivial. And Shannon arguments also don't go through directly because they're too optimistic, really. Like, they don't take into account the combinatorial structure. So often, for some of the models I'll be talking about, you need non-trivial converse ideas as well. Okay? All right. So now let's look at some other benchmark models between the two. So one model could be oblivious adversary. So what's an oblivious adversary? An oblivious adversary is someone where, there is a bad guy. So first of all, your message, you have some private randomness. So there's a short random key known only to Alice, only to the encoder. She uses a short random key along with the message to generate possibly many code words for the same message, right? And then she transmits this over to Bob. Now, the thing is, Calvin, he knows the code book, so he knows the function that maps the short random key and the message to this. He's even allowed to know the message. The only thing he really doesn't know, a priori, is the short random key, okay? So think of it like, the adversary, Calvin, already knows what message Alice wants to transmit. She's some spy, she's sending home the location of the nuclear power plant. But Calvin just doesn't know what language Alice is going to use to shout, roughly. Yeah, English, Hindi, Urdu, whatever. So this language is unknown. And therefore, it turns out that Calvin is not very effective at jamming. There is a way of translating this into schemes where if he has to jam obliviously, then you can get to basically Shannon-like rates, even though it's an adversary who's jamming you, okay? So that's why I put Shannon's picture here. And in fact, there are computationally efficient codes for large alphabets, certainly, but even for small alphabets, binary alphabets, Guruswamy and Smith and so on. By the way, I'm focusing, just for concreteness, I'm focusing on bit flip models. There are other models. There are array models. There are QRE models. There are asymmetric models. There are many other models. And many similar things can be said about those things. But again, just for the sake of concreteness, I'm focusing on bit flip or symbol flip models. Okay. All right. Now, another intermediate model is a common randomness model. This is often, yes. Yes. So that is exactly the model that I just talked about. Wait, okay, so first of all, let's, just for this talk, I'm going to distinguish between message and code word, okay? So message is before encoding, code word is after encoding, okay? Now, in this model, the adversary does not see the code word. He is not allowed to see the code word. That's what I'm calling oblivious. Just because it makes him stronger and it doesn't matter, I allow him to even know the message. Okay, so really, what does he not know? And he also knows the encoding function. What does he not know? He just doesn't know this small private randomness. So think of it like 2 to the epsilon n code words per message, and he just doesn't know which one was used to transmit. Okay, that's the only thing he doesn't know. Okay, the next model, which is the one that maybe you were referencing, is the common randomness model, which is that now, let's even say that there's deterministic encoding, but this deterministic encoding depends, so this deterministic encoding depends on some common randomness S, which is now known to both parties, which is not known to Calvin. Calvin now is allowed to know the code word as well. He can see what is actually transmitted, but he doesn't know what the common randomness was. Okay, so sort of two different ways of using randomness. But in both of these, you basically get back to the Shannon-like capacity. And there are interesting ideas here. One idea, this is not necessarily the optimal idea, but one idea here is you can use a common randomness to permute the bits which were transmitted. So imagine you have a good code, and in this good code, let's say each of the, each code word has roughly n over 2 bits, which are 1s, and n over 2, which are 0. So you could imagine using the common randomness for Alice to choose a code word to transmit, then permute the bits randomly using the common randomness. Now, Calvin puts a noise, but because he doesn't know the permutation and all the code words look equivalent to him under this permutation, so basically when Bob inverts the permutation, the noise spreads out, right? So that's one idea here. That was by Lipton. Then you can reduce the amount of common randomness, and there's a bunch of work in this direction, okay? So order log n bits, it turns out, are enough, and there are computationally efficient codes as well, okay? And by the way, another general theme is, this is common encoding theory. Large alphabet results are much easier. Small alphabet results are often tricky. That's often where the action is. So whatever. Okay. Another model, a weakened reconstruction goal. So now, Calvin knows everything. He really is sort of in the Hamming world, except now Bob is only required to output a small list of messages, hopefully even a constant list of messages, with a requirement that the true message is indeed one of these messages. Okay, this is again classical. It's considered back in the 50s, Ilias, Wozencraft, and so on. And the capacity by now is fairly well understood. So in this case, you can get 1 minus HP minus epsilon with list sizes 1 over epsilon. For the binary case, for the QRE case, and in fact, for the QRE case, of course, there's that classical work, a sequence of papers resulting in the Guruswamy Rudra paper, where you have relatively small list sizes, not quite constant, but polynomially small list sizes, computationally efficient designs, and so on. The QRE case is still the binary case is still open. We don't have computationally efficient designs for these things. We know the list decoding capacity. We know that you can, in principle, get constant list sizes, but we don't know how to do it computationally efficiently. Okay. All right. I think there's maybe one more model. Oh yeah, computationally bounded adversaries. So what if the adversary again gets to see everything, but both Alice, Bob, Calvin, everyone is computationally bounded? In the large alphabet case, there's there's a Mikali-Sudan paper which got a slightly lower rate, but then if you update it using the newer list decoding results, then you can get basically 1 minus p computationally efficiently. For the binary case, it's known for strong reasons that you can't get to 1 minus HP, but if you demand computationally efficient list decoding against a computationally bounded adversary, then you can get that. Okay, so I mean, I'm cheating a little bit here, but it is what it is. Okay, so yeah. So generally speaking, it looks like Shannon is winning hands down, right? And pretty much every way we've weakened the adversary, we've gotten back to the Shannon regime. So that's a question. Is it really the case that this is the Hamming model is really very restrictive, that anything you can do to weaken the adversary pushes it automatically to Shannon? And the answer is no. There are indeed models where the answer lies somewhere in the middle. Okay, and that'll be the work, our work I'll talk about. We presented it at Stock last year, the paper's there. So here I'll be talking about causal adversaries. And so what's a causal adversary? It's something where Alice has a code word she's transmitting, and as she transmits it, Calvin sees it, decides whether to flip the bit or not, or erase the bit or not, and then sees the next one, decides whether to flip the bit or not, and so on. But he has to make these decisions causally. He has a fixed budget of the number of bits he can flip, right? He can't exceed this. But if he uses it too much in advance, then he's kind of screwed. He can't use it later. But he doesn't know, of course, necessarily what he's going to say in the future, right? So that's what I mean by a causal adversary. So that's the slide. And it turns out that the capacity, this is a slightly more complicated thing, but even in earlier versions of this work, for the large alphabet case, large alphabets are easier. It turns out that the answer is not quite Hamming, not quite Shannon, it's sort of shamming, yeah? But for the binary alphabet case, we finally, after, 10 years after we started working on the problem, we finally have a capacity characterization. So this red line is a thing to look at. So just as a benchmark, this is 1 minus HP. That's a bit flip adversary. So that's random noise. You can get 1 minus HP, right? The best known bounds against omniscient adversary are the LP bound is here, and then the GV bounds are here. And then this red line over here, it looks like a straight line. It isn't really. It's actually the binary entropy function up to a point, and then it becomes not quite a straight line, something else. There's an explicit formula for it. This is the capacity for a bit flip adversary. For a bit erasure adversary, the capacity turns out to be 1 minus 2p. That is indeed a straight line. And I'll talk primarily about this, and I'll sort of bypass this. Okay, all right. So let's get on to this, and let's see how much we can actually analyze. So generally speaking, it would be nice to be able to analyze all possible causal adversarial behaviors, and one sort of diagram which will help keep these sort of behaviors in mind will be a diagram of trajectories. Okay, so what do I mean by a trajectory? So think of t being like time, it goes from 0 to n, and so if the adversary was behaving randomly, what's the y-axis? The y-axis is p sub t, so that's the fraction of bits up to time t that have been flipped. Okay, so if the adversary was behaving randomly, if it was random noise, then roughly speaking, you would expect it to be kind of like a straight line. It would be slightly random, there'd be some noise around it, but the benchmark line would be sort of flat over here, right? That would be a trajectory. On the other hand, what are extremal strategies for the adversary? Well, he could flip no bits at all and then flip the last p n bits. Yes. Okay, good. So the x-axis is time, going from 0 to n. The y-axis is the fraction of bits flipped up to time t. So again, it's flat, therefore, for a random adversary, because up to time t, he flips pt earlier. T times p bits, so that it's flat, right? Yes? Yes. So in the binary case,
one,
So you're not wrong. It depends on the model, of course. You could imagine a model where, you know, Alice is transmitting some packets over the internet. The Calvin is sitting in the middle. He's at some node. He sees one packet, decides whether to erase it or not, and so on, right? And that's one model. That would be what I would call the large alphabet model. And I very quickly skip by that. That turns out to be easy to characterize. It turns out in many reasonable models, even a causal adversary is basically as strong as a omniscient adversary. He can, even though he doesn't see the future, he can basically take it all the way to the Hamming world. Okay, so that's earlier work. I should maybe have talked about it a little bit more. Let me just go back here and just show you that slide because it is potentially of interest to people. So, oops, I went too far ahead. I think it is this slide. So, causal large alphabet turns out to be 1 minus 2p. It's maybe a little bit surprising, right? Because the adversary doesn't know the future, but even then, he can basically, there's an attack against any code, not just a deterministic code, you know, even if there's some randomization allowed and so on, as long as there's no common randomness allowed between Alice and Bob and so on. So basically, causal adversary, 1 minus 2p. Large means probably log n. We currently have codes for like, you know, poly n actually, but whatever. Okay. Then there are some models here which actually I will maybe just briefly touch upon in the end, in the summary. So let me just spend a couple of things here. So now suppose he's causal but just delayed by a little bit. Okay, like maybe he just can't see the last epsilon n bits or something. So it's kind of like, you know, bits are coming in. He has to make a decision. By the time he thinks, oh, those bits have gone by, right? So what if his decision is delayed by some constant amount, let's say the last log n bits? In that case, it again shoots back up to sort of Shannon-like capacities, sort of, okay? And depending on the model, then it can be somewhere in the middle, okay? All right. So let's see. Yeah, so extremal strategies for the exactly, extremal jamming strategies, actually it doesn't matter what the model is. So one extremal strategy is to not flip at all and then flip the last pn bits, right? That's clearly one extremal strategy. The other extremal strategy could be to flip everything in the beginning, the first pn bits, and then the average fraction sort of decays as an inverse, right? So really any attack strategy that ends up flipping pn bits overall will be somewhere in the middle. It'll be something in the middle. It'll have some weird thing like this, and it'll have some bounded slope because at one point, up to a certain point, you flipped, you know, a certain number of bits, and then the effect of one more bit can only change the slope by so much, right? So, so trajectory kind of looks like this, okay? So the analysis will be predicated on things like this. Now, first, I'll try to convince you how proofs go, and even though a general proof would require you to analyze, stochastic codes. By stochastic codes, I mean with private randomness available at Alice, and it is doable, but it requires more like technical machinery, which maybe, you know, obscures the fact. So I'll focus for now on deterministic codes, okay? And you'll have to take it on faith that some of these ideas do go through for stochastic codes as well. So so I'll analyze what's called a Babel and push attack. So what's a Babel and push attack? So roughly speaking, like let's say this is the transferred code word. So up to a certain phase, how long? Well, I'll specify that later. But up to a certain point, Calvin, the adversary, just babbles. Okay, he just puts random noise. At a certain level, not p, not the average number of bits he can flip, slightly less than that, he'll be sort of conserving his energy for the last phase when he can push. But he'll still, there'll be some advantage for him to babble in the beginning. Okay. And then once he's babbled enough, so once he's caused as much mischief as he can just by behaving randomly, at a certain point, he'll also have along the way learned something about Alice's transmission, learned enough to do a very specific type of attack, a push type of attack. Okay? So that's a high level. Now what I need to specify to you are three things. One is how long is the babble, the second is what level is the babble noise, and thirdly, maybe most importantly, what is a push? Like, what is the attack strategy for a push? Okay, so I'll do that. So yeah, Babel is just randomly flip some NP bar bits, which is different. Okay, so what's a push? Let's start with that. So in the push phase, from Bob's point of view, so he sees, you know, at the beginning of the push phase, he sees some YL, right? So L is, let's say, the prefix. Where babbling has happened. And by the way, so it's a converse, so we can weaken Calvin And even then, there'll be an attack for him. So how do we weaken Calvin? We weaken him by saying, well, he is always going to do a Babylon push attack, and the parameters of his Babylon push attack, the length of time he'll be babbling, the noise level he'll be babbling, let's say we reveal them to Bob, okay? And even then, there'll be sort of a converse argument, okay? So at this point, when L bits have passed, Bob has seen some y sub L, the first L bits. Now he knows that the roughly LP bar bits have been flipped by Calvin because he knows the parameters of the attack. We've given him that extra knowledge. So therefore, you know, these are the possible prefixes that were actually transmitted, right? The actually transmitted one is this blue one, but from Bob's perspective, each is equally likely, right? So from this point of view, now what can Bob do? So what can Calvin do? So Calvin says, okay, I know this is what Bob is thinking, so let me take the continuations of these code words, okay? So let me take the prefixes that Bob has in his mind, let me complete them, and so I actually don't know. Calvin also necessarily doesn't know the continuation, right? Because he's only seen a prefix as well, it's not clear that he also knows the completion, but he's gonna randomly select a random completion, and he's gonna say, I'm going to choose to try to confuse Bob between whatever Alice is actually saying and this randomly selected one, okay? So if this choice happens at a point in time when there's a sufficiently large set, then, you know, with reasonable probability, this fake code word, the pseudo code word, is different from the actually transmitted code word of Alice's. And therefore, well, if Calvin does indeed succeed in confusing Bob between these two, then with probability half, he'll have succeeded, right? So that's sort of one step. Now what does push mean? So what push means is, he's, for everything in the suffix, everything after the first L bits, he'll look at the ith bit, he sees the ith bit, of course, as it comes, and he sees whether the actually transmitted bit of xi differs from his selected some x bar of I. If it's the same, then of course he doesn't need to do anything, right? They look identical, so he doesn't need to expend any energy, any bit flips to confuse Bob. So he can leave it be. If they're different, however, if 0 and 1 are different, then he could either flip or he could leave it be as long as he does it half the time, right? So half the time when xi and x bar I differ, then half the time he flips, okay? And this would symmetrize it. This would make things look equally likely from Bob's perspective, right? So for this to work, for the push phase to work, what had better be the case? It had better be the case that the number of bit flips available in the push phase is at least half the distance between these two code words, right? And that puts in a constraint on the parameters of this prefix length and the noise levels and so on, okay? So you want to ensure that no matter the code design, Calvin has enough bit flips left to be able to symmetrize in the suffix, okay? All right. So yeah, it's midway between and indeed, you should, but you don't necessarily know, because again, it's a converse argument, so you don't necessarily know. Calvin doesn't know which one it is. He doesn't know which one it is. So
there should be some completion, I guess, or some, like, if you know, Calvin could look at the prefix and say there's no completion that's close, then it's probably a bad choice.
Then what is the bad choice? Okay, so let's consider what could go wrong, right? What could go wrong could be, from Calvin's perspective, that that maybe you know, he has a certain budget, and every pair of code words is very far apart from there, right? Then you know, nothing he does is going to work, right? What this argument rests on is trying to say the following. So and I'll get to that. So what it rests on saying is that if he picks one at random, with reasonable probability, not high probability, but reasonable probability, constant probability, the average distance between a randomly chosen pair will be close to what you would expect. It turns out to be, you know, somewhat critical. That's the underlying machinery. It'll become a little bit clearer with, like, you know, visual aids shortly. Okay.
So it would be with constant probability, but not high probability.
Not high probability. It's like some epsilon. Like, if you try to exceed the capacity by epsilon, then there's some epsilon square or something that shows up, but. Okay, so yeah, so what is that machinery? So there's the Plotkin bound, which many of you probably know about, but bears repetition. It basically says that if you want a code with very high minimum distance, what is very high? So in the binary case, if you want something more than half the minimum distance, and by the way, there are query versions, asymmetric versions, all of that, but if you want, for the binary case, you want a code with more than half the minimum distance, so 1 plus epsilon by 2 for, factor away, well, 1 plus epsilon factor greater than the minimum, than half whatever, then there's just a constant number of code words. Far away from an exponential number of code words, there's just a constant number of code words, okay? So what does that mean? It means that, if these are the possible code words, then if you choose, so these blue dots, these red dots over here are the possible completions from Bob's point of view. Look at any group of them of size 1 over epsilon, then what the Plotkin bound is telling you is that there is at least one pair which is relatively close. Okay? So if you choose 1 over epsilon, like order 1 over epsilon plus 1 or something, like, you know, some constant over epsilon plus 1 code word, at least one pair must be close. Okay? So what that's saying is that with probability epsilon square, if you Alice is choosing a code word randomly in the set, and Bob is choosing his code word, Calvin is choosing his code word randomly in the set, with probability epsilon square, actually, it'll be that pair which is close, right? There's a tighter argument. It gets rid of the square. You can get it down to epsilon. It doesn't really matter. Basically, with the constant probability, the code words will be close. Okay? So what this, by the way, tells us what the budget he should aim for is. What the budget he should aim for is, therefore, in the suffix, he should have roughly a quarter of the suffix length bit flips left, right? Because what this is telling us is that on average, pairs of suffix code words are half the suffix distance away. So if he can flip a quarter of the suffix distance, then Calvin will succeed, right? That's what this is telling us. So that's basically, that helps complete the parameters of the attack, and I'm almost out of time. So, you know, achievability, which is also interesting, I'll not get to, but that's okay. So what happens here? So you can argue by the sort of the converse of list decoding that if this condition is violated, then there must be a large list size from Bob's perspective. It's basically saying that if Alice is trying to transmit above the Shannon capacity for a code word of length L, of the prefix length, then there must be a large list size. And secondly, this energy bounding condition is basically saying that Calvin has enough energy, has enough bit flips left to flip, okay? So it comes down to an optimization problem, and it basically says that as long as both these conditions can be satisfied, so Calvin can choose some p bar to confuse, to make the list size sufficiently large in the prefix, and then flip in the suffix, then he can ensure that no rate higher than this is possible. Okay. Now again, this so a couple of caveats here. This is only for a deterministic code. The way I presented it to make the argument work, even if Alice does something wonky, is kind of, it takes more machinery. Like, you have to start plugging in Shannon-type arguments. You have to plug in Fanon's inequality, a whole bunch of other nice bells and whistles, okay? All right. Achievabilities, I kind of figured this would happen. That's okay. You can read the paper. You can talk to me offline, whatever. But let me just give you a couple of ideas about the achievabilities. So it turns out that this attack almost is optimal. I mean, if you're claiming this is the capacity, then it should better be the case that there's something extremal about this type of attack, and that turns out to be true. So if this is the Babylon push attack, then any trajectory, so here's one key observation, any trajectory is going to intersect the Babylon push trajectory at some point. So at that point, if Bob can list decode and then use the suffix to disambiguate, then maybe you're in business, right? Because think about what this means. So if this trajectory here has this is the real trajectory and this is the reference trajectory, the green trajectory, this is the Babylon push trajectory. So at this point, Calvin has introduced just enough bit flips to be at the list decoding bound, to be sort of at the Shannon capacity of the channel, because the list decoding bound is kind of like the Shannon capacity of the channel, roughly speaking, for an adversarial thing, right? So that means if Alice knew that she's at this point, if Alice knew that the actual trajectory of Calvin intersects the list decoding trajectory here, how does she know? Not clear at all. But if she knew, then she would be able to get, if Bob knew, then he would be able to get a small list size of messages compatible with what Alice is saying. And now Bob has, a constant number of bit flips, a constant number of bits left, the suffix left, to be able to try to disambiguate. Okay, And you know, if you do things randomly with injecting some fresh randomness and so on, then hopefully you can hope to disambiguate. Okay, takes a lot more work, but that's the basic idea here. Okay, how do you find out this point? Well, because a priori you don't know when these trajectories intersect. So what you do is you do it iteratively. You first guess, oh, maybe it happened here. Oh, okay, whatever my decoding rule is didn't work. Let me jump ahead a little bit. Now try decoding. So what does it mean to decode? Try list decoding at this point, assuming that the trajectory intersected here, and then try to disambiguate, look for something consistent using the suffix. Didn't work, jump ahead, try again, and so on. Okay, so that's the essential process. Okay. And I'm out of time, right? Two more minutes. So instead of trying to compress 5-6 more ideas in here, let me just stop there. There's you have to put in randomness, you have to put in fresh randomness every chunk, all of that. I'm going to not talk more about that. I'm going to bypass all of this. My student made lovely slides, but you can just imagine, think of it like a video, right? You can see this later. Yeah, wow, that must have taken a lot of work. Anyway, so, I forgot about this slide, yeah. I'm sort of bypassing these because this is ambitious. So just to remind you, there's a capacity characterization here. Let me just finish with a couple of other models which we're working on now, which are actually maybe even more surprising. So remember, the capacity here is like, something like this, right? And let me focus on something I didn't even talk about, the erasure model, which is 1 minus 2p. Yeah? Similar ideas work over there, so you get 1 minus 2p. Now, here's the thing. It turns out we can extend it to combinations of errors, erasures for a query alphabet, and there's some capacity. But now, if you do the following, if you delay the adversary by even a single bit, so what does that mean? The adversary has to decide whether or not to erase the current bit without seeing the current bit, but everything up to the current bit, jump straight back up to 1 minus p. Okay? So at least for erasures, it's very fragile. Knowing the current bit is critical for him to be at all effective. If he doesn't know the current bit, then you go all the way back. Okay? And knowing the future, by the way, doesn't help too much. So even if you see the next epsilon n bits, the capacity is still 1 minus 2p minus epsilon or something. Okay? So the past doesn't matter quite as much as the current or the future. And the future doesn't matter quite as much either, roughly. Okay, but we don't have a corresponding result for the bit flip case. It may not be true for the bit flip case. There's still stuff we don't understand here. Okay, that's a caveat. And there are other models. And one model maybe I'd very quickly just like to say something about is, well, what if Calvin gets to see everything non-causally, but gets to see a noisy version of it? And again, over here, it's sort of, in many cases, it falls back into the Shannon world. Okay. All right, that's it. I'm done. Questions?